In this video, we'll talk about some basic properties of polyhedral sets, and we'll start by defining a hyperplane and a half space. So what is a hyperplane? It is just a set of points in the Euclidean space of dimension n that satisfy a linear equation p transposed x is equal to t, where p is an n-dimensional vector of coefficients for x and t is the scalar, which is the right-hand side. All right, so the vector p here is called the normal or the gradient of the hyperplane. We can alternatively represent the hyperplane by taking a point through which the hyperplane passes. So let's look at the point x0 such that p transposed x0 is equal to t. So this point x0 belongs to the hyperplane. Then we can equivalently represent this equation here as p transpose times x minus x0 is equal to zero, because if we subtract p transposed x0 from both left-hand side and right-hand side, this is exactly what we are going to get. All right, so this is an equivalent representation for the hyperplane. We can define it as a set of x's such that p transpose times x minus x0 is equal to zero, where x0 is an arbitrary point that belongs to the hyperplane and which is fixed, all right? So if you want to illustrate this geometrically, then in one-dimensional case, of course, the hyperplane will correspond to just a point. In two-dimensional case, when we are looking at a function of two variables here, so we have x1, x2, a hyperplane corresponds to a line, and this line is orthogonal to the normal vector p. All right, and then in three-dimensional case, we are talking about the usual notion of a plane. So we have a plane, again, for which p is orthogonal to every vector that belongs to this plane. And again, the plane contains the point x0, which we use here. So, and when n is greater than 3, then the concept of a hyperplane just generalizes the notion of the plane to higher dimensions. All right. Now, every time we have a hyperplane, it splits the space into two parts. For example, in two dimensions, we know that line splits the plane into two parts, one on one side of the line, the other on the other side of the line. Similarly, in 3D, if you look at the hyperplane, or in this case, it's just a plane, this plane is going to split the three-dimensional space into two parts. Again, one on one side of this plane and the other one on the other side. And these are what we call the half spaces. Okay, so we'll denote by H minus, for this hyperplane H, a set of points such that p transpose times x is less than or equal to t. So you replace the equal sign with the less than or equal to sign here, or in this alternative representation using the point x0, we have the inequality p transpose times x minus x0 is less than or equal to 0. And then by h plus, we are going to denote a set of points that are on the other side of our hyperplane. So this is going to be the set of points such that p transposed x is greater than or equal to t, or in this representation that uses the point x0, the set of points x such that p transposed times x minus x0 is greater than or equal to 0. And of course, it is very easy to check that the hyperplane and both half spaces H plus and H minus are all convex sets. We can easily verify this by using the definition of a convex set. Next, we'll define a convex cone. A convex cone C is a convex set such that lambda x belongs to C for every x in C and lambda greater than or equal to 0. So essentially, whenever you take a point from this convex cone and you multiply that point by the scalar lambda, which is greater than or equal to 0, the resulting point will belong to the convex cone as well. This is how it is defined, right? Now, because of the way it is defined, if we take lambda equal to 0, then this implies that lambda x, which will be equal to 0 for any x from the cone C, will also belong to C. So, which means that the origin will always belong to a convex cone. Alright, so now we can use an arbitrary set of vectors in n-dimensional space given by a1 through ak to generate a convex cone by just considering all possible linear combinations of these vectors with non-negative scalar multipliers lambda i's here. So we are essentially looking at set of all x's such that x is given by the sum of lambda i's a i's for I between 1 and k. And recall that we have k vectors a1 through ak here. And we have all of these scalar multipliers lambda i's non-negative. And this will be a convex cone because whenever you look at lambda x, where lambda is greater or equal to 0, obviously that lambda x can be represented in this form as well, where you will just replace lambda i's with lambda i's times lambda, and therefore for any positive or non-negative lambda, lambda x is going to belong to C as long as x belongs to C. And this figure here provides an illustration for the two-dimensional case, where the vectors are in 2D, and this will be our cone here. So see, we multiply the vectors a1, a2, a3 by positive scalars, and then consider the corresponding sums. So all the points that are obtained this way will belong to this cone right here. All right. Now, this illustration is for a three-dimensional case. In this case, we have these three vectors here, 1, 2, 3, which generate our convex cone. Again, we are looking at all combinations in this form, and the resulting vectors will belong to this gray area here. So this is how a convex cone looks like in this case. So this is the convex cone generated by these three directions here that we considered in 3D. Next, we define a polyhedron, which is just the intersection of a finite number of half spaces. And recall that half spaces are given in the form AI transposed X is less than or equal to BI. Say there are m of them for I between 1 and m. So, and these m half spaces define our polyhedron. All right. Then we can summarize all of this in the form the set of x's where ax is less than or equal to b, where the matrix A is given by the rows consisting of AI transposed for I between 1 and M, and then the vector B here is just the vector of the right hand sides for our inequalities defined in the half spaces. If the polyhedron is bounded, then we call it a polytope. And these two figures illustrate two different polytopes in 3D. So these are three-dimensional polytopes. And it should be noted that some of the inequalities in this representation here can be geometrically redundant, meaning that if we remove these inequalities, then the set is not going to change. So the redundant inequalities don't impact the shape of our feasible region. A special case of polyhedral sets is given by polyhedral cones. What is a polyhedral cone? This is a convex cone, which is a polyhedron, right? So meaning that since it is a polyhedron, it is given by the intersection of a finite number of half spaces. And then because it is a cone, this implies that the origin belongs to the cone, meaning that all of these hyperplanes that define the half spaces, they must pass through the origin. Alright, so we define a polyhedral cone as a polyhedron that is an intersection of a finite number of half spaces whose hyperplanes pass through the origin. So this figure gives an illustration of a polyhedral cone in 3D. And the polyhedral cone can be represented as the set of axes in Rn such that Ax is less than or equal to 0. So a general polyhedral set would be Ax is less than or equal to b, but because all of the hyperplanes defined in the half spaces pass through the origin, all the right-hand sides are zeros, okay? Next, we define a ray as the set of points of the form x in Rn, which is given by x0 plus lambda d for all lambdas greater than or equal to 0. So essentially, a ray is defined by the point x0, which we call the vertex of the ray, and the direction d, which we call the direction of the ray. So this provides an illustration for the two-dimensional case. So here we have the point x0, which is the vertex, and then we have the direction d. So what is a ray? This is just a set of all the points that we can obtain from point x0 by moving along the direction d. So this is our ray shown geometrically. All right, so we talked about the direction of a ray, but next we are going to talk about the direction of a polyhedral set or of a convex set more generally. So if you look at X, which is a convex set, then if for each X0 in the set X, the ray in the direction d with x0 being the vertex belong to the set x, then d is called the recession direction of x, or simply the direction of x. So what is a direction of x? It is a direction d such that if we pick an arbitrary point x0 in the set x and then use this direction d as the direction for a ray with x0 being the vertex of the ray, then the ray will be completely within the feasible set or within the set X that we are looking at. So this illustration provides an example of a direction for our set X shown in gray here. So we picked a point x0 in the feasible region, but it doesn't matter which point x0 we pick. With this direction d, the corresponding ray is going to be within the feasible region. All right, so we can give a couple of more examples of directions for this set or recession directions for this set. So here is another one. Okay, so there are many different directions or recession directions that this set X has. The recession directions are very important from an optimization perspective because these are the potential directions of unboundedness for our problem. If our problem is unbounded, then this can be shown by finding a recession direction along which our objective is going to tend to plus infinity if we are talking about a maximization problem, or negative infinity if we are talking about a minimization problem. Therefore, what we need to do is we need to characterize the recession directions of an arbitrary polyhedral set, and this is what we are going to do in the next theorem. So we want to characterize all the recession directions of a set X, which is convex and more specifically polyhedral because we are dealing with linear programs here. And the set of all directions of the set X is called the recession cone. So we need to describe the recession cone. And this statement here provides the description we are looking for. So given a polyhedral set X, described by the set of all x's such that ax is less than or equal to b and x is greater than or equal to 0, so this is your typical feasible region of a linear program, then the recession cone d is given by the set of all directions d such that ad is less than or equal to 0, d is greater than or equal to 0, and d is not equal to 0. So essentially, how is this set d obtained here? We replace the right-hand sides of the constraints in our description of the polyhedral set with zeros. So instead of ax is less than or equal to b, now we have ad is less than or equal to 0. then here instead of x is greater or equal to 0, you just have d is greater or equal to 0, because d denotes here the directions that belong to the recession cone, right? And also we exclude the d equal to 0, because clearly it's not going to give us a recession direction. So because we exclude the origin, this is not really a cone, right? So we know that for a set to be a cone, the origin must belong to that set. So technically it's not really a cone. So, but this is essentially a cone with excluded origin. So that's why we call it the recession cone. All right, let's prove that D, the set given here, is indeed the recession cone of the set X. All right, so for that, let's denote by D of X the actual recession cone of the set X. And what we want to show is that D is indeed equal to D of X, which will show that D is in fact the recession cone of X. So for that, let's consider an arbitrary direction D, small from D capital, and let's consider a feasible point X. And we need to show that X plus lambda D is going to belong to the set X, which will show that D is in fact a subset of D of X, right? So let's show that if D belongs to D capital and X belongs to X capital, then X plus lambda D will be a feasible point as well. And this will imply that D capital is a subset of D of X. So this essentially shows that all the directions from the set D are the recession directions. So indeed, if you look at X plus lambda D, then in order to show that this belongs to X, we need to essentially show that A times X plus lambda D is less than or equal to B, and X plus lambda D is greater than or equal to 0, because these are exactly the inequalities that define the set X here, right? So to show that A times X plus lambda D is less than or equal to B, let's observe that AD is less than or equal to 0 and AX is less than or equal to B, because the X small belongs to X capital, right? So you have AX is less than or equal to B, then AD is less than or equal to 0, which means that if I look at this product here, we have AX plus lambda AD, then as we said, this is less than or equal to B, this is less than or equal to 0, and the sum of this then must be less than or equal to B, and this establishes the first type of inequality that we have here in the definition of the set X. And to show that X plus lambda D is greater than or equal to 0, just observe that X is greater than or equal to 0 and the D is greater than or equal to 0, because X belongs to X, right? And the D belongs to D capital. So as a result, this inequality holds as well. And we have shown that indeed, whenever we take an arbitrary X that is feasible and consider a direction D small from the set D capital, then X plus lambda D will belong to X for arbitrary lambda, which is non-negative. Of course, you know, we assume that lambda is non-negative, something that I forgot to mention, but clearly when we consider the definition of the recession direction, we are looking at X plus lambda D for all lambdas that are non-negative, right? So we have shown that D capital is a subset of D of X, and now we need to show that the opposite inclusion also holds in order to complete the proof. So we need to show that D of X is a subset of D. All right. So for this, we are going to use the contradiction. So if this inclusion doesn't hold, then there must be an element in D of X which doesn't belong to D, right? So assume there is D that belongs to D of X, and doesn't belong to D. If it doesn't belong to D, this means that it violates one of the defining constraints for D. So we have two types of constraints, AD less than or equal to 0 and D greater than or equal to 0. And at least one of the constraints in this system must be violated because D doesn't belong to D capital, right? So assume that that violated constraint is from this system right here, but the case of D greater than or equal to 0 being violated is established similarly. So assume that for some row J, let's say, of this system, we have AJ transposed times D is greater than 0. Alright, meaning that this constraint here, the jth constraint of this system, is violated. And now recall that D is a recession direction, right? So it belongs to set D of X. And because it is a recession direction, we must have X plus lambda D must belong to the set X for any X from the set X capital D from D of X and any non-negative lambda, right? So this holds for all X in the set X, lambda greater than or equal to 0. So for our D small, because it belongs to the set D of X, this is what we have here, right? This means that X plus lambda D, when multiplied by A from the left, is less than or equal to B, right? In particular, the jth inequality in this system tells us that AJ transposed times X plus lambda D must be less than or equal to BJ for any non-negative lambda. Alright, so because again, this is a recession direction, right? So this must hold for any non-negative lambda. But if we look at this expression carefully, let's copy it here. So you have AJ transposed times X plus lambda times AJ transposed times D is supposed to be less than or equal to BJ for any non-negative lambda, all right? So you have AJ transpose times X is essentially, once you fix X, it's some constant which is less than or equal to BJ because X was the feasible point, right? Then what we have here though is AJ transpose times D is greater than 0 as follows from here. And this must hold for an arbitrary lambda greater than or equal to 0. But clearly, because this term here is greater than 0, I can always select a sufficiently large lambda such that this inequality will be violated. This means that we arrive at a contradiction with the assumption that D is the recession direction. And as a result, there is no point that belongs to D of X but doesn't belong to D, which proves this inclusion right here. And together, this inclusion and this inclusion right here establish what we wanted to establish. It establishes that D is equal to D of X, meaning that D is indeed the recession cone of the set X. Let's consider a simple example illustrating the statement that we just established. So let's look at the recession cone of the following set X. So this is a polyhedral set defined by these two constraints right here, as well as non-negativity. And the corresponding set is illustrated in this figure right here. So this gray area is exactly our set X. In order to obtain the recession cone D, what we essentially do to this system right here, we just replace all the right-hand sides with zeros. Of course, we also change the notations from X to D, but that doesn't really matter. So when we illustrate things geometrically, the set D is essentially obtained from the set X by shifting all the defining lines of the set X to the origin on parallel to their original positions, right? So let's say in the set X we had this line right here, and now it is shifted to the origin. Then we had this line right here, so we have its copy here on this plot as well, and it is shifted towards the origin. And also, of course, in the set D, we eliminate the point of the origin. But other than that, we just shifted all the constraints from the set X towards the origin. And as a result, this is the recession cone that we obtain.
I don't see this major recession coming.
To conclude this video, we define an extreme direction, which is done similarly to how we define the extreme points of a convex set. An extreme direction of a set is a direction that cannot be written as a positive combination of two distinct directions of the set. And the two directions D1 and D2 are distinct if one cannot be written as a positive multiple of the other. Also, any ray whose direction is an extreme direction is called an extreme ray. Returning to our example here, we can see that the set X has two extreme directions corresponding to this line right here and this line right here, and all other directions can be obtained from these two by considering their positive combination.